outstretched arm, I will bless your name.
Continues and continues and continues. even into the day. Take your Bibles and turn to Psalm 145, if you would, please. Psalm 145. It is David's Psalm of Praise. And I want to just share some thoughts with you today as we think about this so special time of the year, Thanksgiving. The joy it is to have a day set apart. We said the robin to the sparrow, I should really like to know why these anxious human beings rush about and worry so. Said the sparrow to the robin, friend, I think that it must be that they have no heavenly father such as cares for you and me. It's good that we anxious human beings, especially those of us who are Christians, pause occasionally to set aside special days of thanksgiving to our Heavenly Father who cares so much for us. I'm grateful that our first president in 1789 proclaimed the first national day of Thanksgiving. And then our 16th president, right at the almost conclusion of the bloody Civil War, proclaimed that we should have a national day of Thanksgiving. He reiterated what the first president proclaimed in 1863. And then in 1941, by the way, they said it would be on the fourth Thursday of November, or the last Thursday of November. Then in 1941, Congress established by official act that the fourth Thursday of November be Thanksgiving Day, because if you had the, sometimes there are five Thursdays and that leaves too few days of shopping between Thanksgiving and that. So they said it always be on the fourth Thursday of Thanksgiving. But anyway, they proclaimed a special day of giving of thanks. It's good that we should gather with our families around firesides and well-spread tables. We have so much for which to give our Heavenly Father thanks. So I want to go to Psalm 145 with you this morning. It's been entitled, as I said, David's Psalm of Praise, or Psalm of David's Praise. I want to see what caused this man to praise God so much. And in so doing, I'm convinced we will be moved in our souls to praise the Lord. And by the way, we've already been moved in our souls to praise Him today. I'm thrilled with what the joy through praise and singing and music that this church has enjoyed today, and I'm sure every Lord's Day. I think in this psalm, there are some questions that will be obviously answered. Number one, David talks about how long we should praise Him, how often we should praise Him, why we should praise Him, and then who should we praise, and what way we should praise Him, and then for what should we praise the Lord. Father, I pray that Thou wouldst direct our thoughts today to Thy Word, through the heart of Thy servant, David, a man after Your own heart. Thank You, Lord, that it was penned this great psalm of praise for our learning and for our admonition. Thank You that in this year that is so full of turmoil and uncertainty and worldwide duress, I pray that we might focus in our hearts today with our families, if You should allow us to, on Thursday coming, just a special time of praise for Your goodness, as has been the tradition since the early days of our nation, our nation's founding. So help us to perpetuate that again with our families in a genuine, heartfelt way, and may it be according to Your Word as we look at it today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. So let's look at Psalm 145. First of all, David answers the question, and these are just no-brainers, but it's good for us to be reminded. First of all, how long should we praise the Lord? Verse 1, I will extol Thee, my God, O King, and I will bless Thy name forever and ever. Notice again in verse 21. Verse 21, let all flesh bless His holy name forever and ever. So that answers the question, how long? There's never going to be a time when we should not praise the Lord. I want to just jump over to Revelation chapter 7, if you would. If you want to turn there, otherwise just read it. This is a flash forward to the future days, in fact, during the tribulation time. John says, after this I saw a multitude, lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne, before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands, and cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne and under the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces and worshiped God, saying, amen. Blessing, glory, and wisdom, thanksgiving, and honor, and power, and might be unto our God. If you're there with me, read with me. Forever and ever. Amen. Forever and ever. Larry, it's good to see you. My dear friend Larry Young just came in from our church down home in Annapolis, and I want to just pause and acknowledge that. I saw him back there. Good to have him with us today. He wrote me early and said, what time are you going to start? Where's it going to be? And I didn't think he'd make it. But he's here. We're just glad you're here, Larry.
Hey.
Thanks for coming. So, like the psalmist, we should vow in our hearts with our lips to praise the Lord. And this will be our employment throughout all eternity. Psalm 63:4, thus will I bless thee while I live, David said. Psalm 146:2, while I live, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praise to my God while I have any being. Praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, his wonderful love proclaimed, as Fanny Crosby wrote. She had much for which to praise the Lord, and we do too today on this beautiful day. So, number one, how long? Number two, how often should we praise him? Let's go back to our text, verse 2 of Psalm 145. Verse 2. And the psalmist says, every day will I praise thee. I will praise thee, thy name forever and ever. So, every day, wake up praising the Lord before you put your feet on the floor. And before you take your feet off the floor tonight, praise him. Praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Psalm 44:8. In God will we boast all the day long and praise thy name forever. Psalm 34:1, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Psalm 35:28, my tongue shall speak of thy righteousness and of thy praise all the day long. Psalm 119:62, at midnight will I rise to give thanks unto thee because of thy righteous judgments. Psalm 119:164, seven times a day do I praise thee because of thy righteous judgment. How often? Every day, all day. In prosperity, in adversity, in sickness, in health, in gladness, in sorrow. Charles Dickens, the author, said, reflect upon your present blessings, of which all of us have many, not upon your past misfortunes, of which every one of us have had some. So we just need to do that. Reflect upon your present blessings. We should do that every single day, and we have the opportunity. A godly farmer was asked to dine with a well-known gentleman, and while there he bowed his head and thanked God for the food, and his host said jeeringly, that's old-fashioned. It's not customary nowadays for people to bow and pray before they eat. And the farmer said, well, with him it was still customary. But some of those on his farm didn't do so. And the host said, well, they're the educated and enlightened. Who are they? And the farmer said, the pigs. It's always proper. Aren't you glad when sometimes you're out to eat and rest and people bow their heads and pray before they eat? Nothing more precious than see a couple that's obviously been married 50, 60, 70 years, and they hold hands and they join their hearts in prayer, thanking God. So how often? All the time, every day, in the morning, at noon, and at night, and sometimes during the night. Okay, number three. Why should we praise him? Verse 3. Let's go to verse 3. Great is the Lord. Psalm 145:3. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. Well, that's the answer. Because of his greatness. His greatness. Isaiah 40:28. Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, faileth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. Romans 11:33. Oh, the depth Oh, the riches of both of wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. He's a great God. His greatness is beyond. In fact, if you just read, as you might have already done so, Psalm 146, glancing down through there, 147. Praise ye the Lord, it is good to sing praises unto our God. It's pleasant, it's comely. The Lord builds Jerusalem. He gathers the outcast of Israel. He heals the broken heart. He bindeth up their wounds. He tells the number of the stars. He calls them all by their names. Great is our order. Great power. His understanding is infinite. The Lord lifts up the meek. He casts up the wicked down to the ground. Sing unto the Lord with thanksgiving. Sing praise upon the heart of our God. And just go on and on and on. It's just, it's beyond our finite minds to grasp the greatness of God, but we have some expressions of it here. And it's a challenge to us all. There was a little fellow in the hospital that had delicate surgery, and a piece of his bone had been removed from his arm. He was going to go home, and the day that he was going to be released, his surgeon came by and to check in on him, and the little fellow said, "My mom's never going to hear the end of you. My mom's never going to hear the end of you." It's kind of like our little grandson, our second grandson. He had one eye that turned in, and when he was a little fella, he had surgery. I forget how old he was, maybe four. And his parents said, "Well, how do we?" And afterwards, "You're going to have to wear glasses for some time." And my parents, or his parents, said, "How's he going to wear? How are you going to make a 4-year-old wear glasses?" And this eye doctor said, "He'll wear them because when he wears them, he can see, and when he can't, when he doesn't wear them, he won't be able to see straight." So, sure enough, after surgery, he wore them. But you know, that surgeon had a place in his heart and our hearts. And a surgeon does that, or a man or a woman that is able to minister grace by the power of God through healing and help. And Tim doesn't wear glasses now. He can see straight, and he's studying to be a dentist, but that doctor made all the difference. You probably had some surgeon in your life. I know Ellen has recently, with cancer surgery, that has made a difference. And that doctor, somebody's never going to hear the end of that doctor. We're going to talk about it. We're going to recommend him. We're going to tell people about him because of what he's able to do. Well, people should never hear the end of it. We should talk about them all the time. Number four, verse four, who should praise him? One generation shall praise thy works to another and shall declare thy mighty acts. One generation shall praise thy works to another and declare thy mighty acts. Who? Well, Psalm 44:1 says, "We have heard with our ears, our fathers have told us what work thou didst in their days and times of old." If you've got a mom or dad, or a memory of a mom or dad that told you about God, about Jesus, or a grandmother, or a friend, or a teacher, what a blessing you have had.
Yeah.
There was a lady that taught school, and she actually was a radio host that he had a program on the air called Job Center of the Air. And the host said that of the 2,500 people that he had helped find a job, only 10 sent a thank you note. He was surprised and somewhat hurt, he said, that only 10 out of 2,500 whom he helped find a job. Well, hearing about that, a teacher, a retired school teacher. And by the way, can you think of some of your teachers?
Yeah.
I can think of some. I can name some of them. Miss Flommy, my 8th grade English teacher. Miss Sharp, music, and teaching me music was a challenge because I love music. I love it, but I don't understand it. I couldn't play a note. My mom and dad asked me to learn the piano when I was, and they paid for lessons for a year, and all I could do is hit middle C if I had a good day. So after a while, they let me play football in the afternoons instead of taking piano lessons. But I can remember my teachers. And I think I wrote one of them. But anyway, this one particular teacher said, she received a letter from a former student thanking her for her role in his life. She responded immediately with these words, "I can't tell you how much that letter meant to me. You'll be interested to know that I taught school for 50 years, and yours is the first note of appreciation I've ever received. It filled me with cheer." It's important to, like the one leper that was cleansed, to go back and say thank you, isn't it?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And many of you have done, sacrificed your lives for children, grandchildren, and friends, and you know what it, you know what it means to have, somebody just say thank you. Some children, some grandchildren say it almost instantly, immediately, and others never seem to say it. You know, I thank the Lord for the first Thanksgiving. I thank God for those pilgrims that came over in 1620. They left they left for New England or for America. I think 100 and some came over. They came through choppy waters and storms, 66-day journey it was. There was one hired hand on the ship that the pilgrims were in what was called the tween quarters. It was between the deck and the lower, and they had about 5 feet of headroom, and they had 100 people packed in there for 66 days. And they kept their sanity by singing psalms. They sang psalms, praise to God. One of the hired hands up on the deck cursed them and said that he would have a happy day when he saw some of them tossed overboard because they died of, of sickness, which no doubt they would die of. Interesting, though, that not one of those pilgrims on the boat died of sickness. That boat had been used as a cargo ship for wine, to carry wine back and forth, and it spilled in the seas and in the storms, and the boards were soaked, wine-soaked, and actually acted as a disinfectant. And all the pilgrims made it, that man that said he would be happy to see one of them cast overboard because of sickness, he's the only one on ship that died. He got a bad case of sickness. He wasn't down there where the disinfectant was, and so he died. But they survived. They came, and they had struggles. They were supposed to land at the headwaters of the Hudson River, not Plymouth Rock, but further toward New York. But for two reasons they didn't. Number one, there was a bad storm, and number two, they later found out that some merchants had paid the shipmaster to redirect the ship. They wanted that part of New York for themselves, so they ended up at Plymouth Rock. And they had, of course, struggles. There was a Frenchman who was captured and was about ready to be put to death, and the natives had captured him, and he said, "You better not kill me." He said, "God, the God of heaven, the pilgrim's God, he won't look kindly to this. You'll have trouble." Well, they laughed and said, "There's none of your gods can kill our God." So they shot the man. Squanto was you've heard of him in history book history. He was a Indian who was captured and taken to England for a while. He was learned English well and studied, and then was released from whatever he was taken for, maybe a servanthood, and was able to get back to England, New England. And the pilgrims buried a lot of folk the first winter. They did so under the cover of darkness so the Indians couldn't see how many of their number had shrunk. But Squanto came back, and he found that there were very few Indians. Come to find out, they had been, most of them who were there when the pilgrims landed, had been killed in a bad plague. The ground had been cleared, was ready for planting, but nobody had planted it, so Squanto told the pilgrims how to plant the Indians' staple, winter corn. They did so, and in the fall of 1621, they had a bountiful harvest. And they gathered together, not so much to thank the Indians, who were not, all of them not hostile, of course, but to thank God for his goodness to them, and yeah. allowing them to survive. And that's, you know, the rest of the story. William Bradford, the governor of the colonies, proclaimed a giving of thanks day. And then 150 years later, first president proclaimed, as we've said. And then 1863, Lincoln, and then 1941, Congress. So we can praise him one generation to another.
Amen.
I hope you will have the opportunity this Thanksgiving to tell our grandkids something of God's goodness to us as a nation. He's been so good.
Amen.
Next question. In what ways should we praise the Lord? Verse 5. I will speak of the glorious honor of thy majesty and of thy wondrous works. And men shall speak of the might of thy terrible acts. I will declare thy greatness. They shall abundantly utter the memory of thy greatness and shall sing of thy righteousness. In what ways? Well, did you notice in those verses I just read these action verbs? Verse 6, speak. Verse 6, declare. Verse 7, utter. Memory. Verse 7, sing of thy righteousness. In those ways, and probably others, Hebrews 13:15 says, by him therefore let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is, of fruit of our lips, giving thanks unto his name. Giving thanks unto his name. So we have the opportunity to sing praises, to share words of testimony, personal testimonies. It's sad to have a group of folk in Jesus' name meeting together for worship, and when they are asked to give a testimony, there's utter silence.
Yeah.
Maybe sometimes people say, I better not speak because I spoke last time, or I don't want to hog the show or whatever, but we ought to just be quick to stand and praise God. Praise him for his greatness, his goodness, his glory, his salvation, his faithfulness, his oh-so-great salvation. His unspeakable gift, which is what Paul spoke of in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. So in what ways? Just every way. In your heart, with your lips, in silence, in song, with people, by yourself, praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Number 5, what should we praise him for? Again, maybe this is 6 if you keep track, but it doesn't matter. The last question I want to ask is, what should we praise him for? And let's go to verse 8, please. The Lord is gracious. His graciousness, and full of compassion, his compassion. Verse 8, his mercy, slow to anger and of great mercy. Aren't you glad for that?
Amen.
He's impartial in his goodness to all of us. Verse 9, the Lord is good to all. His tender mercies are over all his works. Verse 9, his tender mercies, and then verse 12, please. To make known to the sons of men his mighty acts and the glorious majesty of his kingdom. Mighty acts and glorious majesty of his kingdom. Verse 13, thy kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Thy dominion endureth throughout all generations. Of his kingdom there shall be no end. Now that we know who is the sovereign Lord of the universe. Now the Bible says Satan is the small g god of this world. He's the prince of the power of the air. He's having a heyday now. He's a great deceiver. He's got people's, generally the world, eyes blinded to truth. But God's kingdom has not ever been thwarted by man.
Amen. Amen.
And sometimes we're overwhelmed with what man does to man. The wickedness of man. My wife heard a radio program interview of a man, a missionary that had been to the Himalayas over in the Far East. I think it's somewhere near India, the mountains. Himalayas. He had visited, and he said there were no girls. People that lived there had sold their girls to people who were merchants in human beings. For $100, they sold their young girls to the wicked men. That's just beyond our comprehension, is it not? How humanity can be that depraved.
Yeah.
And by the way, that's just one of countless of stories we could recite that just illustrate a new man's inhumanity to man. And it seems like wickedness is on the throne, but God is still ruling. Jesus is coming back, Bible says, to establish the kingdom. We were reading a devotional of Charles Spurgeon. We read it every day, evening and morning, his devotional booklet. And back in his day, mid to late 1800s, a lot was not said about the future, as future events, the tribulation. But he did use the word millennium. That might have been this morning's lesson. You got to believe in the millennium if you read the book of the Revelation.
Amen.
Now, some people don't believe it. They say, well, it's just a spiritual use of the word. But no, it's millennium means 1,000. Mm-hmm. And he's going to establish his throne when he comes back from Jerusalem, Zechariah 9:9, and other places. And he's going to rule and reign 1,000 years as king. Mm-hmm. Brother Larry read Matthew 25, and that whole chapter context was about when he comes back to establish his throne. And there'll be a judgment when he does. And separation of the sheep and the goat, saved and unsaved nations. So anyway, it's exciting. But his kingdom, as it says in verse 13, is everlasting. Verse 14, notice his sustaining power. The Lord upholdeth all that fall and raiseth up all that be bowed down. Verse 15, his faithful provision. The eyes of all wait upon thee. Thou givest them their meat in due season. Verse 16, thou openest thy hand and satisfieth the desire of every living thing. And then verse 17, his righteous and holy character. The Lord is righteous in all of his ways and holy in all of his works. Verse 18, his love, his condescending love. The Lord is nigh unto all them that call upon him, and to all that call upon him in truth he will fulfill the desire of them that fear him. He also will hear their cry and will save them. Verse 19, he answers prayer. We just read that. He will hear their cry and will save them. And then verse 20, his preserving grace. The Lord preserveth all them that love him, but all the wicked will he destroy. So why should we not praise him? We should praise him. For what should we praise him? We just read a few here. There are so many, many more things that we can say. God of my life, through all my days, I'll tune the grateful note of praise. Doddridge Philip wrote these words, poet. The song shall wake with opening light and warble in the silent night. When anxious care would break my rest and grief would tear my throbbing breast, the notes of praise ascending high shall check the murmur and the sigh. When death or nature shall prevail, and when all powers of language fail, joy through my swimming eyes shall break and mean the thanks I cannot speak. But oh, when that last conflict's o'er and I am chained to earth no more, with what glad accents shall I rise to join the music of the skies? Then shall I learn the exalted strains that echo through the heavenly plains and emulate with joy unknown, glorious seraphs round thy throne.
Yeah.
Praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. A person does not realize how much he has to be thankful for, somebody said, until he has to pay taxes on it. Be grateful for what you have, not regretful for what you do not have. It's not what you have in your pocket that makes you thankful, but what you have in your heart. Cannot be content with what you have received, then be thankful for what you have not received, what you've escaped. Amen?
Amen.
Well, I must close the message with these words. Thanks to God for my Redeemer. Thanks for all thou dost provide. Thanks for Jesus, Thanks for times, but now memory. Thanks for Jesus by my side. Thanks for pleasant, balmy springtime. Thanks for dark and dreary fall, like yesterday. Thanks for tears by now forgotten. Thanks for peace within my soul. We can go on and on and on and on. I personally could, you could. Thanking God, praising Him for bringing Him to Himself. For the soldier that knocked our door when I was 6 years old, after my mom and dad had lost an 11-year-old son in a drowning misfortune. We call it misfortune. It was all in God's providences, but God saw fit to allow my brother. I was 5 or 6, and he was 11. And my 8-year-old sister was by out in the creek, a farm creek, with a cousin spending a night. Cousin said, "Let's go swimming in the creek. Can you swim?" "Yeah, Teddy," my brother said. Well, he couldn't really. Thought he could probably. Got caught in a hole. Couldn't get out. Drowned. And my mom and dad, who had made a profession of faith in Jesus at an evangelistic meeting, at least my dad, I'm not sure about my mom, when she got saved, but she was saved. They were both saved, but they lived within a stone's throw of an old dead Methodist church. Nothing against Methodists, but you know, it was kind of church that when people got there, the leader, class leader said, "Anybody got a lesson to teach today?" Nobody was prepared for teaching anybody anything from the Word. Thankfully, they did have a Bible school that summer where my brother went to Bible school, and I believe he got saved. We didn't think he did. But anyway, through that incident, my mom and dad said, "We've got to find God." They moved. Dad got a job at John Deere. Tumwine was just 30 miles up the road. And they got settled in their new city, and they said, "We've got to find God. God's doing something in our lives."
Yeah.
So they began to look. They went to the Catholic Church and didn't find anything there that would help them. Went to other churches, didn't find anything that would help them. One night, a neighbor out in the country knocked on their door and said, "Come to church with us tonight, would you?" They did. It was a church just like this one. They had good gospel hymns they sang and Bible message from the Word of God from a faithful old preacher. And they heard the truth and they said, "This is where we need to be."
Yeah.
I got saved there a few weeks later and got baptized. And the Lord eventually put His hand upon me to preach. That's one story. We can multiply by hundreds. Thank God from whom all blessings flow.
Amen.
Thank Him that most of all that He drew us to Himself and saved us and gave us eternal life. It was Thursday that I conducted a service for an old soldier. He answered his last summons and was called into the Lord's presence. John Henry was his name. If he signed his name, it was John Henry. And it was John Henry. But he got saved. His young man lived for God all of his days. He and his wife, who was his wife for 72 years until she went home in March of this year, was called to her heavenly home. John was 94 when he passed away about a week ago. But his wife lived on the south side of Minneapolis probably at least 62 years, most of their married life. Same little old humble house on Edgecombe Avenue, south side. But they believed in Jesus Christ. They lived very humbly. I don't know if they were, he had a good job, he worked for the railroad, retired railroad, but they didn't live like they had anything. They just lived frugal lives. But they had one thing that was unmistakably clear, that is their love for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Love for church. As long as John could come, even after his wife passed, with his wife, he came as long as he could until, because of health issues, he couldn't bring her. So he stayed home. But I'm so glad for him. And I could be here on next Sunday, tell about the people like John that God's brought in, and Larry, Pastor Larry could too, into our lives, without which we would have no ministry. People like you, and you, and you, and you, and you, who sing, and who come, and who give, and who say amen, praise the Lord. Larry's one of them back here. God allowed me in his life. Larry has a, a daughter. Her name's Michelle. She went to Pastor Huffan's camp up north as a counselor when she was a teenager. I've been in Bible school, Michelle Young. When she was a child, she had a desire to be a missionary. That desire never left her. She got to be college age. She went to college down in Greenwood, IBC, learned scripture. Didn't have any young man show any interest in her, but she finished college and she surrendered to be a missionary to go to a field that eventually became a closed door. It was not wise for her to go there. Her mission board advisors instructed her she probably should pray about a different field for whatever reason. I can't remember. But so she did. She said, well, if I can't go there, where can I go? Zambia opened up. She said, you can go to Zambia. So she raised the board all over the U.S., crisscrossing back and forth, presenting her burden in her ministry as a single gal. And she got her support up. She went to Zambia as a single gal. It's not a very pleasant place to live, even as a married couple. Third world minus. Third world minus. While she was there, she met a young man. Harrison was his name. She fell in love with him, and he with her. And they got married, and they're there today, and they have been for many years. Living in a home that most of us couldn't live in for a week, minus most of the comforts of life, most of the luxuries that we take for granted. Flip a switch and there's light. Turn a spigot, there's water. But they live there, and she loves it. Oh, it's hard. But God touched her heart as a young person. Larry, if I might say so, as my dear friend, opposed her going to the mission field. He wasn't saved. She went without his blessings, without his approval. Then one day, God allowed me to sit down with Larry in my office and present the gospel. And he bowed his head and heart and said, ask Jesus to be his Savior. He's been behind Michelle and Harrison ever since, and other missionaries too. He lives in the world. Oh, what God can do. What a blessing. I'd love to hear your story. I'd love to hear everybody's story. What a blessing do we, what a testimony. What a praise we have to raise to our God. Would you take your hymnals and turn to 300 if I could ask you to do so? Count your many blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. It'll surprise you. But it's something that we ought to do and we can do. Larry, you want to come lead it, and I'm not going to give an invitation unless Brother Larry wants to. We ought to just at least sing from our hearts about the blessings of God. Let's stand as we sing.